Hey, and welcome back to the Parkinson's Disease Education Podcast. In last episode, we discussed in detail a lot of the cellular changes that happen in Parkinson's disease and how mitochondrial health plays a key role in what causes the issues with that cellular health and ultimately leads to cell death in Parkinson's disease. I'll leave a link to that up here so you can watch it again if you didn't happen to catch that episode, or in the description below. I'll also leave a link there. In this episode, as I promised, we're going to dive into a little bit more about what we can do to actually help that mitochondrial health and to basically help the cells that are sick already to get better, hopefully also to prevent future damage in cells that have not been damaged by Parkinson's disease yet. So in other words, we're looking for neuroprotective effects from things that we can do or things that you can do in your life and lifestyle. So get ready. We're going to be talking a lot about lifestyle changes. What kind of changes are we talking about? It's lifestyle changes that could include dietary changes as well as supplements that you might consider adding to your regimen to help with cellular health. And that's what we're going to be talking about in today's episode. I hope you'll stick around till the end. Now, without further ado, we're going to start the episode in a 3, and a 2, and a 1, and hit it. Welcome to the Parkinson's Disease Education Show, where we demystify the disease and empower you as the person with Parkinson's disease to reach your true potential. The content contained on this show is for informational purposes only, and is not meant to be a replacement for information or advice that you receive from your in-person medical or therapy professionals. If you haven't already, I hope you'll consider subscribing. And for an even more personalized experience, please ask us about our memberships. Now, without further ado, let's start the show. So a brief summary of what we talked about in the previous episode is this. We discussed the damage that can be done to the cells that produce dopamine. That damage can come from environmental factors such as toxins, exposures, etc. It also can come from genetic causes, and we discussed that at length last time. Without going into that again, briefly, whatever has caused the damage results in essentially mitochondria becoming sick and damaged within the cells that produce dopamine in the substantia nigra pars compacta. That results in not only impaired dopamine production, but it can also result in premature cell death of those cells in that region. And once those cells are gone, they don't come back. So one of the things that's a key hallmark of mitochondrial damage, regardless of the cell type we're talking about, is that there's a release or an increased production of what's called reactive oxidative species, or ROS. Now, obviously, oxidative species are released quite commonly in the body, but at an excessive level, ROS causes a lot of problems and essentially results in cell damage and death. We've all heard the hype about oxidative stress, but it really is a real thing that is a concerning factor, and especially since it's linked with so many issues related to Parkinson's disease, it's really worth the time to focus on oxidative stress as a potential issue in Parkinson's disease and how we could make that better. You might ask, why is this area of the brain particularly susceptible to all this reactive oxygen species being released and all this oxidative stress? Well, one thing that I've read that's a possible explanation is that reactive oxygen species tend to result from stress. It could be external stress, such as toxins. It could be other stressors, just general stress on the body. But something else that is important to remember about the nigra striatal cells in the substantia nigra of the brain, those dopamine producing cells, that area is an extremely high traffic area. So those signals are traveling through that part of the brain at rapid fire almost constantly, because so many bodily functions, they just depend on dopamine, and movements regulated in that area, coordination of movement and so forth, all that. It's just a high volume, high traffic area. Those neurons are firing all the time. So one theory that I've come across is that there's such a high traffic, high volume area that area of the brain is always taxed and stressed. And so it kind of naturally lends itself towards more react, reactive oxygen species just because the mitochondria are always working overtime. And if you add environmental toxins, exposures, and stresses on top of that, it can make it even worse and potentially lead to that idiopathic or development from causes outside of genetic causes. As we talked about in the previous video, there are genetic links to Parkinson's disease, as well as folks that get Parkinson's disease with no known genetic cause. But in either case, you could have someone with genetic predisposition to Parkinson's that has the genes turned on by some environmental or external stressors. You could also, in turn, have somebody that does not have the genetic link to Parkinson's have those same exposures and perhaps have cell damage done, mitochondrial damage done due to those exposures or those stresses, and that induces the disease process. Regardless of which case we're talking about, the reactive oxygen species released from those cells would be higher even under normal circumstances, regardless of damage done by external factors. So something I wanted to talk about first is ketogenic diet. Dr. Christopher Palmer, in his book Brain Energy, talks at length about mitochondrial health and the various conditions that are the result of impaired mitochondrial health and damage and cell death, mainly in the form of mental illness, but Parkinson's disease does come up at least once. We certainly know Parkinson's disease results from issues with mitochondrial health and damage, and reactive oxidative species are definitely one of the results of that mitochondrial damage. So that said, one of the possible or potential things that Dr. Palmer recommends is a ketogenic diet. Now, ketogenic diet is not the only way to achieve ketosis or increase ketones in the blood, but ketosis is possible through a ketogenic diet, and that can come in various forms. Now, at its strictest level, starvation induces ketosis. So I'm not recommending any of these, by the way, outright, but just letting you know what is possible. Starvation in its mild form might look something like intermittent fasting, where you're eating only at certain periods of the day and fasting for the remainder of those periods of the day. At any point where your body is in a fasting state, you're going to be in a higher state of ketosis. Another form of a ketogenic diet is the carnivore diet, where essentially your entire diet is composed of meat, especially red meat, and which is high in protein. The carnivore diet is not something that most medical professionals are going to recommend due to the fact that basically you're really only getting one type of food and you're not getting a more of a balance of the fat and carbohydrates that you would with a standard diet. However, it can be said with pretty high certainty that a high carbohydrate diet is not going to be as good, especially in terms of ketosis. But if you Google ketogenic diet, there's different versions of that available to look at online. There's different dietary plans that you might find there. But just suffice it to say that a ketogenic diet is one way, whether it's a more strict form or whether it's a little bit more middle of the road, going to result in improved ketosis. And that ketosis is going to reduce oxidative stress that results from the ROS, from the damaged mitochondria we talked about in the last episode. So take that advice with a grain of salt. Look up ketogenic diet and possible diet plans. It may not be right for everybody, and so I'm not outright recommending that. I highly recommend you at least look into it and consider it as something that could be a way to more naturally improve your health, and especially mitochondrial health, and reduce that reactive oxidative species that's produced by the damaged mitochondria. Now, we've talked about dietary changes, but something else that's really important to consider is supplements. Now, basically what I'm going to do now is just list a handful of supplements that I think would be really important to consider when you have Parkinson's disease and why they may be important to consider in a future video, actually multiple videos. I'm going to have a goal of going into some of these supplements in more detail and essentially how the mechanisms could help in the case of the symptoms of Parkinson's. So some supplements to consider. The first is glutathione. There's also NRF2, NAD+, and CoQ10, or coenzyme Q10. One other supplement I almost forgot to mention is creatine. So creatine is an important substance, important chemical in the body, particularly for muscle contraction. But I'm not going to go into all the details about creatine, but that is another great supplement that could potentially help with mitochondrial health and improving damage caused by reactive oxygen species. It could even, it's said to have possibly even reduce the release of reactive oxygen species, and we'll talk about that more in a future video. Those are a handful of supplements that are really good for reduced oxidative stress. So again, if ROS is a main byproduct of damaged mitochondria, it's really important to look into whatever you can do to reduce oxidative stress. And those are a handful of supplements that can do that. Finally, I wanted to mention high-dose thiamine or vitamin B1 as a potential remedy to help mitigate some of the symptoms of Parkinson's disease. Now, vitamin B1 is not something that necessarily affects oxidative stress or helps with redox reactions. However, it has been shown to help with the symptoms of Parkinson's disease in many individuals. I'll put a link in the description to Dr. Daphne Bryan's book, Parkinson's and the B1 Therapy. I highly recommend you check that out. I haven't discussed this with Dr. Bryan herself, but she does have a Facebook group dedicated to this where she will answer questions. And she follows the protocol recommended by Dr. Constantini, who is one of the pioneers of this method of supplementation. In short, high-dose vitamin B1 is thought to help increase the release of dopamine within the cells in the brain. So that's possibly why it helps. In addition to vitamin B1, another supplement that's really important to consider is mucuna pruriens. Mucuna pruriens comes from a bean, and it's basically a potential way to improve natural dopamine in the body that could be an adjunct to your existing treatment. Mucuna pruriens is not likely to work as well as a standalone method of treating Parkinson's disease, even though it is natural. It just doesn't necessarily have the volume that you would need to really get the dopamine levels you might need, especially with more advanced Parkinson's disease. I'll talk more about mucuna in more detail in a future video, but just suffice it to say, that could be another good supplement to consider taking alongside the medications and other lifestyle changes such as diet and exercise. Again, as I mentioned before, I'd like to dive deeper into each one of those supplements in future videos to kind of give you a little bit of a better overview of how they might work to help not only reduce oxidative stress or whatever other ways they may help, but also things like vitamin B1. So what we talked about today is by far not an exhaustive list of supplements or even things that you can do to help to improve mitochondrial health and reduce oxidative stress, but this is a great start. So I'd encourage you to look into some of this on your own, but also look forward to future videos where I'll be discussing these in more detail. As always, I'd encourage you to reach out with questions, whether in the comments or by reaching out to me directly. I'd be happy to provide my email address, but also I've got a link to book a call with me in the channel information page or on the channel links above to get consultation if you'd like to have a deeper dive into some of the things that you're dealing with. Some of that also comes in our memberships, and you can find links to those as well in the description. By the way, a quick plug for my friend David with Life with Parkinson's channel. This t-shirt comes from his channel, and he's got a bunch of other ones on the channel store. I'm going to leave a link up above and in the description so you can check that out and do support him. He's a great guy, and especially if you are interested in learning a little bit more about his perspective of, as a person with young onset Parkinson's disease, I'd highly encourage you to visit his channel and to look at his videos. Thank you so much for being here for this episode. I look forward to seeing you in the next one. As always, be empowered. Have a great day.